and it causes a condition that often happens in that situation called inbreeding depression, where the plant will lose its ability to produce sexually. So that's one reason why, and also because those populations are not common. The plant is very it's very rare in the Mazatec region. It's not something you stumble upon. Usually, it's always grown in a shaman's garden, or you know, sometimes they'll plant it in a remote ravine that they tend the plant. And actually, often they deliberately plant it in out of the way locations because they believe that passersby who don't have the right intention or good energy, so to speak, can actually rob the plant of vitality, just like a person who glances at the plant could potentially rob the plant of energy or possibly even transfer some kind of negative stuff to the plant. That's what they believe anyway. So they'll often plant it in remote locations just so that it will be sort of protected from that kind of thing. I don't know. I want more detail.
You mentioned earlier about salvia being a real entheogen, and Hoffman and Shulgin not knowing, not being able to isolate any constituents from it.
Right.
You know, people write me asking if salvia is a real entheogen or if it's just a party drug. How do you answer those types of questions?
Well, you kind of got two questions there. You're asking about Shulgin and Hoffman not being able to isolate anything. Well, it turns out, knowing what we know now, that the reason that they were unsuccessful, their approach was, you know, a sensible one, which was they were making various extracts. And they did some basic things like testing for alkaloids, which, you know, is kind of a first step thing you would do, looking for an active constituent in a plant drug. And Salvia divinorum doesn't, the active constituent is not an alkaloid, so they didn't find any. But they also separated the plant, well, they produced extracts and separated extracts into various fractions and then tested them on themselves. They both took this approach. They just, you know, extracted it, separated the fractions, and then consumed those extracts. And nothing happened. And after, you know, trying several different approaches and not getting any results, you know, at one point, I know Hoffman, originally he brought back he made an expedition to the Mazatec region together with Gordon and Wasson in 1962 and collected fresh leaves and preserved them in jugs of alcohol and brought that material back with him. Some was whole leaves and some was crushed, some was basically leaf juice that they produced in the, well, during the trip. They had the Mazatecs crush some leaves and squeeze the juice out, and then they brought that back preserved with alcohol. But when he brought this back to his lab at Sandoz in Switzerland, the first thing he did was try those things. Nothing happened. After not getting any success with that, he managed to get a live plant sent to him from Mexico, and he grew this in a greenhouse in Switzerland at Sandoz. And once he had enough material, he experimented with the fresh leaves. He did that because he thought, well, maybe the active constituent is not preserved well, you know, the alcohol, and it needs to be taken fresh. But even when he did that, he wasn't getting any results. So, you know, after a certain amount of effort, he just, you know, decided it wasn't worth pursuing any further. The same thing basically was what happened with Alexander Shulgin. But what we know now is that salvin RNA, the active constituent, is not well assimilated through the gastrointestinal system. Once you swallow it, it's unlikely to produce any effect. And some people claim that that by swallowing large amounts of leaf juice that they get some effect that way. But typically, if it's just swallowed, people don't experience anything. It turns out that if you hold the leaf juices or just chew the leaves for an extended period of time, that salvinorin will absorb through the oral mucosa in the mouth cavity, and enough will get into the bloodstream to produce an effect. So absorbing it through the oral mucosa allows the compound to get into the bloodstream intact, but once it's swallowed, it's probably deactivated by enzymes in the digestive tract or possibly during first pass metabolism by the liver. It's more complicated. It's called PDP, a compound in the gut that is an active transporter that may actually actively prevent it from passing through the intestines. We don't know for sure, you know, exactly which of those mechanisms is at play, but we do know that salvia doesn't really work. Certainly, in most cases, it doesn't seem to work when it's just swallowed. And this is what Hoffman and Schulgen were doing, is they were swallowing these extracts, and so that's why they weren't getting an effect. And the reason, you know, nowadays a lot of people in the West, the Mazatecs never do this, but a lot of people in the West smoke salvia. And, back in the time when they were investigating the plant, they did not smoke it, presumably because the plant is always traditionally taken orally, for one thing, but also they were informed that the plant has to be used fresh. This was information from some of the Mazatec informants that Gordon Wasson interviewed. They said that the plant can't be used dry, that it had to be used fresh. So obviously if you're going to smoke something, you would have to dry it first. So it was a long time before people started experimenting with smoking it, and I think some people were sort of surprised that it had actually worked that way. It turned out the information that was put out by some of those early Mazatec informants wasn't accurate. It's not true. It does work when dried.
How are the Mazatecs using the salvia, that, orally, but in what ways specifically, do we know?
There's two ways that they typically ingest it. I don't want to forget to come back to your other question about it being a recreational versus a true entheogen or whatever.
Right.
But they typically either the preferred method is to chewing the leaves. That is what most of them say works best, and it is what works best when you're taking the leaves orally. They'll just take a pile of leaves, and the dose really varies depending on the size of the leaves and what exactly the person they're giving it to and so forth. But typically one of the numbers that you hear a lot is 26 leaves. That's because it's basically 13 pairs of leaves, and the reason that number is commonly used is because pairs have a special magical significance to them, presumably because it represents male and female. And the number 13 also has some special cosmological significance to them. So 13 pairs is a special number for them, and it happens to be a pretty good dose in most cases for chewing salvia leaves. But they're not, that's not rigid. Sometimes they'll take 6 or 8 leaves, or sometimes they'll take 200. It really varies a lot. Partly because the leaves vary a lot in size, for one thing, but also presumably because sometimes they want a stronger effect or a weaker effect. So just chewing the leaves, they'll make a bundle. Sometimes they'll roll it in a little cylinder, so you can just sort of chomp away on it. It's like a cigar-shaped cylinder. And take a mouthful and chew it up and chew it well and swallow that mouthful and take another mouthful and work your way to get to the end of it. With a bundle of like 26 large leaves, it can take a good 15 or 20 minutes to get through that pile of leaves. And basically your mouth cavity is being coated with this leaf juice during that entire period, which that allows sufficient time for you to get enough into the bloodstream to produce an effect. If you take that same 26 leaves and, for example, grind it up in a blender with some water and make a slurry so that it can be gulped down quickly, it doesn't produce an effect. Gulping that same amount down quickly doesn't produce an effect, but obviously that's not what the Mazatecs do. But there is another approach that the Mazatecs sometimes use, where they'll crush the leaves up, usually on a stone grinding instrument called a matate, they'll crush the leaves up and to a pulp, and then they'll squeeze that pulp to extract the leaf juices and mix that juice with some water and then drink that. And that tends to produce a much milder effect, presumably because the leaf, the mouth cavity is not, you know, staying in contact with the leaf juices as long as it would be when the leaves are being chewed directly. But those are the two ways they take it, and they always take it in a very highly ceremonial manner. It's a very serious affair, taking salvia. They don't do it lightly. They always do it when there's a serious issue at hand that needs to be dealt with. And for them, it's they use it to consult with the supernatural world, and so they'll, you know, when there's a client, you know, if a shaman has a patient or client, whatever term you want to use, who's having some kind of problems, health problems or other issues in life that are thought to have some kind of supernatural cause, they'll take salvia, sometimes they'll use mushrooms and other things. Tobacco also, you know, I should mention, is part of their kind of ritual sacred plants that they use. In fact, tobacco always accompanies their, you know, all those sessions, whether it's mushrooms or salvia, tobacco is part of it, although I should point out that they don't usually smoke it, although sometimes they do make homemade cigars out of tobacco. The primary way it's used is they make a paste from the fresh tobacco leaves. They'll grind up the fresh tobacco leaves with lime, not the fruit, but the, you know, lime from limestone. And sometimes I'll add a little garlic to that, and that seems to be not too often the case. But they'll make this paste, and it's called pisiete, and it's considered to have a high spiritual value and have protective powers and so forth. And they'll rub that on certain parts of the body during the session, rub it on the wrists and the forehead and things like this. And sometimes they'll rub it on the gums, and obviously rubbing it on the gums actually tends to produce an effect similar to chewing tobacco. It's not really a psychedelic effect, but it definitely has an effect that it has to the experience. But primarily, I think the main reason it's incorporated in sessions with other vision-inducing substances is for protective power. It's considered, you rubbing on certain parts of the body, it protects you from bad spirits and things like that. I should go back a little ways in terms of how they use it. They use it in a very sincere way. The sessions that they do are primarily filled with religious chanting and prayer. They're very prayerful sessions. They don't sit around in silence very much. They, you know, sort of like I might do, sit around in silence a lot, sort of delving into my inner psyche. They spend this experience praying for aid for the problem at hand and asking often verbally for vision. They associate Salvia Divinorum with the Virgin Mary. In fact, they really kind of consider it an incarnation of the Virgin Mary or you know, what they call the Virgin Mary now, but their idea of the Virgin Mary seems to be blended with some pre-Christian goddess figure.
Don't they also relate it to another name was Virginia de la Pastora or something like that?
Well, they have several names like that. Yerba de Pastora, Herba the Virgin. The Virgin that they're talking about is the Virgin Mary. Mary's herb.
Let's go back and let's hit that one question and about salvia being a real entheogen versus party drug. And
yeah, well, entheogens is kind of a tricky word, but unfortunately there's no perfect word to describe these kinds of substances.
It's funny that you mentioned that. I've had Carl Ruck on my show twice, and I've been to his place, and he's a pretty adamant atheist, and he's the one who created the word.
I didn't know that about him. That's
yeah, Yeah, it had nothing to do with a God connotation, because he's talking about developing your God within, but not like a general theological sense of God.
Right.
But go ahead.
Yeah, although it's tricky because the word theo means God, but I see.
Exactly.
That's interesting to know that. Anyway, what